Hello and welcome to my presentation. My name is Rahul and I'm a PhD student at University of Stavanger. This is a joint work with the NSFT. So today I'm going to present a technique to detect fake news. So without further ado, let's get started. So what is a fake news? So fake news is a type of hoax or information that is meant to be misled. So a news story qualifies as a fake news if it is published and written with an intent to mislead, which wants some incentives like to gain either politically or financially. So let's see some of the examples to see how serious is this problem. So for the first example, you might have noticed, you might have already read this story about fake news affected the presidential election in Brazil. And one more interesting story is related to USA. So a few years back, because of a fake tweet, some people hacked official accounts of AP and they tweet about bombing in the White House. So that costed $134 billion to the US market. So you can imagine how serious this problem is. So some more facts about fake news. So the spread of misinformation or fake news online has become wider, and day by day it is increasing because more and more people are using this digital media to consume information. So there is a paradigm shift in a way people consume information nowadays. So as per the World Economic Forum, rapid spread of misinformation is one of the top 10 challenges of the current world. So due to this, there is a rise of fact-checking websites, like you might have seen one of them, like Snopes and PolitiFact and FactCheck.org. But the problem with those websites are there are human beings sitting doing this dirty job of deciding whether this is fake news or not. So this process is very tedious and time-taking. So we don't want to do that, we want to avoid that. So automated fact-checking is the need of the hour. Then we move on to state-of-the-art works that are there and what are the limitations and our key contributions. So what, in what ways we are different. So we can divide the previous work into three categories mainly. So the first kind of works, they deal with only the content of the news. So either they use some stylistic features, some linguistic cues like AOS maybe, part of speech. And also they use some lexicons. Those are lexicons manually created by people. And they may use source reliability, at what venue or in which portal this news was there. So it's in BBC or it's in some crappy news portal. But the problem with this approach is it heavily relies on tedious feature engineering or handcrafted features. Next set of work, they deal with social context. So they use, on top of the content of the news, they use social context to learn some evidence. So essentially what they do, they try to capture user interaction with the news. So user comments, user replies, user likes and dislikes. And they also, in some work, they also use sentiments, what user feels about the news. But the problem with this approach is unavailability or scarcity of the information. So not always each news has user comments or user interactions. The third set of work, which is pretty recent, they try to use external evidence. So they use web documents. So they use fake news or false claim as a query. They search on the web and they get some results. They filter out based on some filtration technique. And then they use those results as an external evidence. So most of them, they use deep learning based methods to avoid feature engineering. And pretty recent work, which we use as a baseline, it's a state of the art from EMMP. It uses claim text to guide the attention to select the salient and significant words in the document. But there are certain problems and gaps in this approach, which could be contextual cues are confined to only text of the news, but there are other aspects which can be considered, which we consider. And they apply attention on the word level only, so, but word, they don't exist individually, but they come together and they form a sentence. So sentences are more important than word alone. But we want some hierarchical attention or encoder to even select the salient sentences, not only the words. So as a conclusion, we can say there is a clear scope of improvement that we can do. So let's move to key contributions, in what ways we tackle these challenges that I have described. So the first one, we use hierarchical attention rather than just simple word level attention and hierarchical encoder, because the web documents are hierarchical. They are not just words, they are sentences form document. So the architecture of the neural net mimics the architecture of the document. So this is the same architecture, it's a better representation. And then what we do, we also use latent aspects, and we use latent aspects to guide the attention. And I will come later what is latent aspect. And then we also propose an evidence extraction algorithm, which is a byproduct, and we get a snippet out of those documents. And that is very crisp and user-friendly to see. The last one we tried is interpretability of the model. So we should know why this model works or why it decided that this claim is false or true. So we visualize the learned embeddings and the attention rates. So now let's see what latent aspects are. So for a claim, we consider three attributes, that is subject of the claim, author of the claim, and the domain. Subject is the topic of the claim, topic of the text, and the author is who said that claim. So maybe Donald Trump or Hillary Clinton, who is that author. And the domain is, when we search that claim on the web, we get some search results. So where did those search results were published, like if BBC, is New York Times, or which domain? So we call them latent aspects because they don't play any direct role in deciding the veracity of the fake news. But in a sense, we hypothesize that if we use attention guided by them, they will guide the attention to more significant words, contextual words. Like if you use domain author as a Donald Trump, you might find frequent words used by Donald Trump. Let's say great, or Germany, or UK, something similar, Obama. So let's see this example, intuitive example, to show what those latent aspects are and how they are useful. So let's say claim is Obama administration was begging for a meeting with Kim Jong-un. This is said by Donald Trump, so the author is Donald Trump. And the subject of this claim is nuclear. And when we search this claim on the web, we found an article from Washington Post. So the domain is Washington Post. So we can see, this is a cherry-picked example. So with Donald Trump, we are able to select words like president's claim, which is not appearing in the claim. Like Trump is lying. So we are able to attend this thing because of the author-based attention. Similarly, in similar fashion, in subject attention, we apply subject-based attention, and the subject is nuclear. So we are able to capture words like North Korean leader or North Korea's nuclear program, which is otherwise not, we cannot attempt. And similarly, in domain-based attention, we are able to capture the writing style of the journalist, how he writes, where he wants to emphasize or highlight. So some of the very rare words people use in their writing style, so we can capture that. So now let's move on to what is the problem statement and high-level approach. So we have textual claims, bunch of textual claims, and those textual claims are associated with some author and some topic. We use these claims as a query and we search on the web, let's say Google, and we find some results. And this credibility check engine, we have lots of components. So at the end of the what you want to do, we want to predict whether this claim is fake or real. And as a byproduct, we also get a snippet out of it, which is the evidence. So in more intuitive way, let's say the claim was, this is the same claim we have already discussed. We queried on the web, we got some such results, and we apply a deep neural net model. And then at the claim level, we aggregate. So because a claim, when you search on the web, the claim as a query, you will find many results. So we need to aggregate at the per claim result. And then we find the fake or real label for each claim. So essentially what happens is, let's say this claim was searched and we got this result. And when we open this, we found this evidence. There's no public records or news article shows Obama tried to meet with the Kim. So that's how deep learning model will learn automatically this, where to focus, and then we'll decide this is false. So now let's move on to what is latent aspect-based attention. So at the input layer, we have word embedding, word representation of both claim text and document text. So red blocks are, let's say, claim text, and the green ones are document text. And then also we have an aspect vector. Aspect vector is, we have each, for each aspect, we have an aspect embedding, and these vectors are coming from the aspect embedding. So we pass this word embedding to bidirectional LSTM as an encoder, and what we get is hidden states for each word. Then we use these hidden states to train a very tiny neural net, a single layer, to come up with the attention weights, to which words are important, which are not. But what we do different is, we also use aspect vector in the computation of those weights. So we compute those weights at alpha, and we multiply with the hidden states. And then we get the sentence representations. So now we have sentence representation, so sequence of sentences. And then again, because it's hierarchical, I told you already, so we again pass these sentences to the bidirectional LSTM, and we got hidden states. And then again, we apply attention to the same neural net, and we get betas. And notice that we also use aspect vector for the computation of the betas. Then we get the document representation. So this is the underlying model, but the whole Sartre model is like, is different. It has more parallel models. I will come to this later. So mathematically, what happens is, it's the same, it's a very standard attention mechanism that you can find in each attention paper. What we did different is this, this term. So there is a weight matrix and the aspect vectors that we introduced in computation of the attention weights. So that's what we do differently. So what is the overall Sartre model? So you might remember this thing, the claim word embeddings we have and the document word embeddings we have, we concatenate them. We pass to three models parallelly. We call it subject model, author model, and domain model. And then we get the document representation from each model, and we concatenate these document representations. And notice that these three document representations are for the same document. And then we apply a softmax layer, and we get the prediction whether it's true or false. So underneath each of these three models, we have same architecture. So we have three parallel, this unit. So let's say this is the unit. So we have three units in parallel, and then we train jointly. Let's go more in detail with this section. So what we are doing here is this DSB and DAU and DBO, they are coming from three models, subject, author, and domain. We are concatenating them, and we get the overall representation we call DSAG. And then this is passed to a dense layer with 10H activation, which will transform it to a binary space. And then we apply softmax layer to this D pin, like representation of the document, overall representation, and we get probability, the classification probability whether it's true or false. But how agent aspect embeddings are trained? Because we don't have any embedding to train with. So we start with an embedding which is like initialized with uniform random weight. And during the process, when we train the model, so with the backprop, the error propagates to this tiny model that we use for attention, and which also trains these embeddings. So let's say at epoch 1, some of the weights were trained, and then at the end of the training, at epoch n, all the embeddings are trained, so it's fully trained embeddings. And at the test time, you will be using this fully trained embedding to test. So let's move on to experiments. So what data set we use? So we use three data sets. One comes from smooth.com, another from Bullet Effect. And the third one is Fever data set, which is not for fake news detection, but we wanted to benchmark our model for entailment tasks. So we use Fever data set. So these are the statistics of data sets. So in Bullet Effect and Snopes, there are close to 4,000 claims, and we retrieve web documents from the web, close to 29,000 in both the cases. And we have subject, author, domain attributes for Bullet Effect, sorry. And for the Snopes, we don't have subject and author attribute, but we have domain attribute. In case of Fever, however, the claim and document are already present in the dataset. We don't have to query them to the web. And it does not have any subject, author, or domain attribute. So we had to create topics using LDA model. So does it outperform existing approaches? So this is the result. So we compare with the convolutional neural net, that is UNKIM et al. For document classification. We also use hierarchical LSTM and hierarchical attention network. And then we have variation of our model, that is S-HAN, A-HAN, D-HAN, and the club model, that we call SADHAN. It's not SAD-HAN. It's Hindi word SADHAN, that means tool. And it outperforms all the baselines in both these data sets. In case, we also compare our model with Declare, which is the state-of-the-art model. And we outperformed Declare, but the difference between this table and the previous table is that this is per claim aggregated result, and that was for each claim we have a label. So how useful are learned embeddings? We did some analysis to see whether learned embeddings are useful otherwise. So this is author embeddings. So each embedding was of 100 dimension, but we used TSNE to plot it in two dimensions. So very interesting thing you can notice that people from different ideology are clustered together, like Barack Obama and Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump and Ted Cruz. So we are able to learn more than just false claim, whether these people are associated is there a connotation with the false claim or not, but you're also able to capture their ideology based on their claim. And the subject embeddings, we can see the most striking thing I could see is like climate change and healthcare are very closer in the space, and they are more involved in false claim ratio. The false claim ratio is higher for them. So, but in federal law or civil rights, they are far from these, and they have very less false claim ratio. Interestingly, domain embeddings, we found all the trusted sites like Washington Post or NY Times or Reuters, they are clubbed together. And all the sites which are not trustworthy in some sense are clubbed together. And there is a third cluster in which the sites are in between. So can evidences be extracted? Yes. So this example, so let's say claim is there is substantial evidence of voter fraud, and it's said by Donald Trump. And we searched this claim on the web. We got the result from Guardian.com, and the topic of the claim was elections. So just using claim-based attention will give you this. This is declared. We visualize this also. But when we use author domain and subject-based attention, we get more interesting things like White House, which is connected to Donald Trump, and Trump Commission. So we get more interesting results. In case of domain-based attention, we are able to capture this word glaringly empty, which is very rare word. Maybe it's a style of the journalist. And similarly, we are able to capture passingly rare, which is also kind of style of the journalist or style of the portal. So in the case of subject-based attention, we are able to capture things related to elections. So state election chiefs, what they are saying, and the Commission on Election Integrity, what they... So we are able to capture more context rather than just using claim-based attention. And then we utilize, we propose algorithm, which I'm not covering here, but you can refer to the paper. So we, it's a very straightforward way of using both word level and sentence level attention weights, and from the all three model and combine them to generate a snippet, which is this. So which is very crisp and useful. So as a conclusion, I can say that aspect-based attention is more effective if it is used with claim text-based attention, but only text-based attention is not sufficient to detect the veracity of the news. And by visualization, we show that our embeddings are pretty useful, otherwise also. And we proposed an evidence extraction technique which generates crisp and useful evidence snippets that can also be used for extractive summarization tasks. So I want to also thank SIGAIA Student Travel Grant for supporting my travels. And I invite you to my poster if you have any queries. Thank you.